Hi, today we are going to solve an interesting problem. Given an array, we have to find a subarray whose sum is maximum among all possible subarray sums. This subarray will be referred to as the maximum sum subarray or the MSS. A over here is an array of size 10. Its indices are marked from 0 to 9 over here. In this problem, the array can have both positive and negative values. A subarray is defined as a continuous part or section of the given array. As you can see, minus 5, 7, 6 form a subarray. The sum of this given subarray over here would be 8. In this lesson, we consider subarrays to have at least one element. The subarray that would give the maximum sum is from 7 to 11 with a sum of 19. Now let me take one more example. To make things more clear, B is an array with all negative values. Therefore, its MSS would be minus 1, its highest value. Instead, if the array contained all positive values, we will have the whole array as our MSS. Now, the first approach that we are going to discuss over here is a brute force algorithm. We are going to form all possible subarrays, find their sum, and find its maximum. That is, we're gonna form subarrays of size 1, 2, and so on. Let us see this algo in action. We will take a variable called answer. As we iterate through each subarray, we will calculate each of its sum. Answer will store the maximum of these sums seen so far. That is, each time we calculate the sum of a subarray, we compare it with the value in answer. If it is greater, then we update answer with the sum that we just computed. So before we form subarrays and start finding the sum, we initialize answer with a highly negative value. Int min is a macro available under the C limits header in the C++ language. This represents the minimum value that can be stored in an integer variable. Different languages have different ways to represent this constant. We start with a high negative value because we want a value which is lesser than all possible sums in answer. For instance, if answer was 0 and the array was filled with negative values, then finally we'll have 0 in answer and not the real maximum. So first, we have subarrays of size 1. We find its sum and update answer with the maximum. Then we move on to subarrays of size 2. We find each of its sum and then update answer with the maximum of answer and the sums. We move on to subarrays of size 3 and finally subarray of size 4. Now that we've seen the algorithm in action, let us see how we can code this. I'll be using C or C++ code throughout this lesson. Maximum sum subarray is a function which accepts an array and its size as its parameters and returns an integer value, the sum of the maximum sum subarray. First, we iterate over all possible subarray sizes, starting at 1 and ending at n. Then, we iterate over all possible start indices for these subarrays, starting from 0 till n-1. This condition checks whether the subarray that we've got is a valid subarray. For instance, in the previous example that we saw, if the subarray size was 2 and the start index 3, we have an invalid subarray and we need to ignore it. Once we get a valid subarray, we need to calculate the sum. We iterate from the start index of the subarray till the last index of the subarray, which is start index plus subarray size minus 1. To calculate the MSS, we need to take the maximum value of sum. Answer is initialized to int min available under the C limits header, which is a high negative value. In the end, answer will contain our MSS, which we'll return. Now let us calculate the time complexity of this function. If you do not know how to calculate time complexity, please refer to our videos on that. The link is available in the video description. We have three loops over here, each of time complexity O of n, and since it's nested, the overall time complexity is O of n cube. Now we can see how we can improve our algorithm, reducing the computations by either using previously calculated values or by changing the order in which we do some specific tasks. Now when we considered subarrays starting at the same index, we were calculating the sum from the start separately for each subarray. This was because we considered subarray size first and then the start index. But if you notice over here, the sum of each of these subarrays is its previous sum plus the last element of the subarray. That is, to calculate the sum of the subarray of size k, we take the sum of the subarray of size k minus 1 at the index I and add the last element to it. For each subarray of size k, we'll be saving k minus 1 iterations every time, saving valuable computation time. So now, let us see how we can implement this new approach and how it improves our time complexity. So instead of deciding upon the subarray sizes, we'll decide on the start indices first. We iterate over all possible start indices, and then we iterate over all possible subarray sizes. It ranges from 1 to n, and again we have to check if the subarray that we have is a valid subarray or not. Now since we'll be taking the sum of our previous subarray, sum is declared outside the subarray loop. To sum, we will add the last element of each new subarray, which is basically subarray size minus 1, since array size minus 1 is the last element of any array. Finally, we use a variable called answer to take the maximum of all the sums and return it. Now for the time complexity of the given function, we have two big O of n loops, both of which are nested. Therefore, the overall time complexity is O of n square. So we reduce the time complexity from O of n cube to O of n square by making a simple observation. Next, we are going to look at a technique called divide and conquer, where we will divide our problem into subproblems and use their results or use their answers to compute our answer for the main problem. Coming back to our previous example, let us divide the array into two, left half and right half. Now imagine that we know their results already. Now imagine x is the array we have and y is a subarray of x, which is the answer that we need. Now let us figure out what are the possibilities for y's position in x. For our first case, y, which is the maximum sum subarray of x, could lie completely in the left half. In that case, the answer is already computed. Similarly, y could lie completely in the right half of x. In that case also, we have our answer computed. The last possibility is that y lies both in the left and right half. That is, the start index of y lies in the left half and the end index lies in the right half. So if indeed this was the case, we need to figure out the best possible answer where the start index lies in the left half and the end index lies in the right half. Now, we are going to figure out the best possible start and end indices independently. Starting from the rightmost point in the left subarray, we'll figure out what is the best possible sum we can get. Similarly, starting from the leftmost point in the right subarray, we figure out what is the best possible sum in the right. Therefore, the sum of the best possible subarray whose start index lies in the left half and the end in the right is simply the sum of these two variables. At each step, we recurse over the left and right half of the array. Now, we have reached to a case where we have an array of size 1. This will be the base case of our recursion. When there's only one element in the array, the value itself is the MSS of that array. Now, we have an array whose left MSS is 3, right MSS minus 2, and the best possible subarray through the middle as 1. Therefore, the MSS of this array is 3, which is the maximum of all these three values. Similarly, We have an array whose left MSS is 5, right MSS is minus 1, and the best subarray through the middle as 4. Therefore, the answer that we'll get from here is the maximum of all these three values, which is 5. Finally, we have the answer as 6, which is the maximum sum subarray for this given array. Let us look at how we can implement this solution. First, we take care of the base case condition. When n is 1, the element itself is our answer. Then, to divide the array into 2, we calculate m, the size of the left subarray. We recurse over the left half of the array. For that, we call the same function with the same array pointer but the size of the left array. Then, to recurse over the right half of the array, we increment the array pointer by m. The size of the right half will simply be n minus m. To calculate the left sum and right sum value just like how we saw before, I have declared two variables. Both of them are initialized to the most minimum possible value. Sum will take care of all the intermediate sums. To find the right sum value, we start from the leftmost point in the right subarray and find sum of all subarrays starting at that point. And then we take the maximum of all those values and store it in right sum. After resetting the sum variable, we start with the rightmost element in the left subarray and do the same to calculate left sum. Finally, the answer will be the maximum of left MSS, right MSS, and the sum of left sum and right sum. Let us try and analyze the time complexity for the divide and conquer technique that we've used over here. Let T of n be the time it takes for completion of a program with an array of size n. When n is equal to 1, we have the base case where we do constant number of operations. Then we recurse over the left half and the right half, each of size n by 2. And then, combining the two loops, we do operation proportional to the size of the array. Writing that mathematically, we have T of n equals C when n is equal to 1, denoting constant time operations, and when n is greater than 1, we have 2 T of n by 2 plus C dash n. On solving this recursion, we get that T of n is equal to C n plus C dash of n log n. In the big O notation, it is nothing but n log n. The recursion over here is very similar to that of merge sort algorithm. If you do not understand how the recursion works or how we derive the time complexity of this function, please refer to the videos on merge sort for that. We've so far seen three techniques for solving this problem. Next, we are going to see an approach called Cadenet's algorithm. In this algorithm over here, we are going to solve this problem in a much more simpler manner. That is, just by going through the array once, we will calculate what is the MSS of that array. We are going to find the MSS of this given array. Initially, we start with an empty subarray, and as we keep discovering elements, we will try and add it to this subarray. We will also keep track of the sum of this subarray. This value will help us determine whether we can add a new value to the subarray or we reset the subarray to the empty subarray that we started with. The original algorithm assumes that there is at least one positive element in the given array, so we can safely initialize sum to the value 0, which is the sum of an empty subarray. Now, when we start iterating, we will add the element to our subarray. If the new sum of the subarray is positive, we will keep the element in the subarray and move on. Now, since the maximum value of sum will be the MSS of our array, we need another variable to keep track of the maximum. Now, moving on to the next element, we see that adding that value to our sum becomes negative. In that case, we reset our subarray to the initial empty subarray. Moving on, adding the next value, we get a positive value in sum. So we keep the value in the subarray and update answer to the maximum of answer and sum. The next element makes sum negative, therefore we reset the subarray. Now let us quickly look at how this algo works for the rest of the array. Now, since these two values keep the sum positive, we keep adding it to the subarray. As long as sum remains positive, we will keep adding the element to the subarray. And when sum falls negative, we reset the subarray to the empty subarray that we started with. In an array at an index I, sum will try to calculate the MSS ending at I. That is, of all the subarrays which end at I, sum will try to calculate which is the best possible MSS. Now, since we have the MSS ending at I, to form the MSS ending at I plus 1, we can add to the MSS ending at I. The MSS ending at I could have been both positive or negative. If it was positive, I can add my current array value to it and try to get a better answer in the future. But if it was negative, I am always better off by not considering that subarray. That is why when we get a negative value in sum, we reset it to the initial empty subarray that we started with. In all other cases, we keep adding it to the subarray. Let us see how we can implement the solution. I start with two variables answer and sum, just like how we saw before. Answer will keep track of the maximum values of sum, which will finally contain the MSS. We iterate over the array once, visiting every element just once. As we saw previously, if adding it to the previous sum, my sum remains positive, I will add the element to the subarray. Here, it is just represented by adding the value of the array to the variable sum. In the other case, we have to reset it to the empty subarray. Here, it is represented by resetting the sum value to 0. We take the maximum of sum in answer and finally return the MSS of the given array. Now let us quickly calculate the time complexity of this given function. Since we visit every element in the array just once, the overall time complexity is big O of n. The original Cardanese algorithm works only if the array contains at least one positive element. So if the array were to contain all negative values, we need to have a separate check checking if all the values are negative and then return the maximum if that was the case. So having a quick recap, we saw four approaches. The first approach was an n cube approach, where we saw all different possible subarrays and took the maximum. We later improvised it with an n square approach, and then we used the divide and conquer technique to arrive at an n log n solution. And finally, we saw the Cardanese algorithm, which runs in O of n time. All the code that has been shown in this video tutorial will be available in GitHub. The links will be posted in the video description. Thank you.